campaign with myself, Molly King, and Victoria Pendleton.
Okay.
We've all designed our own personalised chocolate bars.
Okay.
And the whole premise is to raise money and awareness to help prevent HIV being transferred from mother to baby.
Okay.
And it's quite an important campaign, and when I was approached about it, it resonated with me. Being a new mum,
of course,
as well, and just wanting to help, you know, spread the word, really. And actually, it was an area that I didn't know a lot about. So I wanted to learn more about it. We got to go out to Ghana,
right,
and we got to learn a lot more about it.
Well, listen, we'll talk about the trip to Ghana after we've seen a little clip.
Okay, great.
She has actually completed my life.
Oh, she just looks like a little angel.
This is my sunshine.
Should I show you my sunshine?
Yeah.
This is Azura. I love her so much.
Yeah, she's got your eyes. I'm now a living testimony that an HIV-positive woman can actually give birth to a negative child.
It doesn't matter which country you're from, what your background is, who you are, you have something in common. All you want is for your baby to be happy and healthy, and that's the most important thing in the world.
And as little as 25p can make such a big difference to their lives.
It only takes 25p for the medication. It's incredible. And just Galaxy are going to be donating 5p per bar, and obviously that will go towards the Global Fund and to make sure that the medication can continue.
How many bars have you eaten so far?
I've eaten quite a few, actually. Isn't that so sweet and lovely, though, that something as enjoyable to us
absolutely
and simple as buying a chocolate bar can literally save lives. It's so important.
What was it like for you to go out there?
It was amazing. I've always wanted to go to Ghana, and I got to spend time with Connie, who you just saw there. And Connie is an AIDS activist who actually lost 3 children back in the 90s because of HIV. Fortunately, since the new medication, the ARVs, she's gone on to have a healthy little girl. And she's such a strong woman, and I learned so much out there. You know, I went to hospitals, I went to the clinics, I went into schools, and really got to know the people and to try and understand the stigma behind HIV.
Did it change you as a mother?
I wouldn't say it's changed me as a mother, but you just come home with this sense of gratitude. I feel so lucky. You know, my daughter's happy and healthy. You go out there, and I spent time with so many newborn babies in the hospital. I was in my element. And all you want is for their mothers to feel secure, to encourage the mothers to get tested, encourage them to take the medication, because they can literally save their unborn child's life by just a simple act of that.
What a great thing to be involved in. And how's yours? 11 months?
11 months yesterday. Yeah.
She recorded her first album yet?
No, but I have written a song for her. She's so good. She's teething, so she's a little irritable at the moment, but she's learning how to speak. I'm trying to get her to say mummy, and every time I say mummy, she says daddy.
Oh, yeah, of course.
And it's just, but she's just adorable. I love spending time with her.
And so you've written her a song?
I've written her a song, yes.
That's lovely.
Yeah, I know. It was one of the loveliest experiences I've had in the recording studio.
You've got a bit teary.
No, I'm not. It's just the light. But yeah, I held a picture of her whilst I was recording the song as well, and it was just so lovely to put all that in, because you go through so many emotions. You have a baby. It was just lovely to put that in a song.
So we're going to get some new music from you soon.
Got new music coming. Yeah, I've been working so hard and trying to juggle looking after Azura and making sure I get the album done. It has been a bit of a challenge, but it's been such an enjoyable experience. I've never had such a good time.
And what sort of music?
Well, I mean, it's music that I love, music that's got soul, music that tells a story. But then there's so many different sides to my personality, you know, whether it be club music, whether it just be great songs with great meaning. There's a balance on there, and obviously, you know, mainstream, and I always try to make sure that the music that I do will appeal to lots of different types of people.
Yeah, is music still the main job, would you say, then?
Music is my passion, Alid. That's the thing that I think about every day. That's the thing I've dreamt of doing my whole life. And when I feel at my best and when I feel like I'm being myself is when I'm on stage, when I'm writing. So yeah, I would just say that's my passion, and I couldn't do anything else.
Because you could have been a sports teacher. Because you were on the way to Loughborough, weren't you? I wanted to go to Loughborough.
That was apparently the number one university for sport. I did a diploma in sports studies at college, and before I got into the music industry, that was my focus. It just seemed like a more obtainable career than being a musician, obviously. Yeah, so I had a love of sport, and that's definitely what I probably would have done had I not.
But the whole Mystique thing happened. And you were only 18. What I love about this whole story is that everyone thought that you were so South London.
Yeah.
And you were sort of leafy Hertfordshire.
I was from Welwyn Garden City, yes. I know.
That tricked them.
I know. Everybody thought I was from South London. I know. It was quite, I mean, the whole thing thing about Mystique in the beginning, the fact that I would go out, you know, into clubs and I'd get on the mic and I'd start emceeing and I'd be there in a little dress and I was, you know, it was odd. It wasn't seen back then at that time. You didn't get many female MCs. So.
Did you get fed up people asking always if you're going to get back together and stuff? I think everyone just wants to see you on the big reunion and then everyone will be happy. But well, you're doing your own thing though, aren't you?
So I don't get fed up. I mean, I loved being in Mystique. I was in Mystique for 8 years and everything that I do now is a result of being in the band. So I'll never get tired of people asking. I mean, Sue Elise lives in Australia now, but she's over here visiting and she's going to come and see me next week for a cup of tea and a catch up.
And hold the baby.
And hold the baby. She hasn't met Azura yet.
And what about the TV career? Because we've seen you presenting loads of different programmes and we see you on the judging panel. That's going to come round again soon as well. You're going to be involved for that forever? Or?
Well, who knows, Alid?
Would you like to?
I mean, I love doing the show. I love it. It's one of the most enjoyable experiences that I've had working on television. You just laugh constantly. You don't feel like you're at work. I mean, it feels cheeky to call it work.
They must be like a creche there all the time now.
They would need a creche if all four of us come back. They definitely would need that. 100%.
It seems that you've built up a lovely friendship with Amanda as well.
I have. Amanda's such a sweetheart. Yeah. I've got so much time for her. I actually spoke to her this morning. She's such a girl's girl. And before I joined the show, she actually called me up and she said, let's go for a coffee, let's go and have a chat. And that was lovely, and I knew from then we would get on, and I never thought I'd meet somebody with a filthier laugh than me, but I did.
And she's got some pretty filthy jokes as well, hasn't she?
Oh, she does, she's so naughty.
Is it true that your mates all call you Monica?
Yes.
Because why? Because you clean a lot.
Because I like a clean house. Yes.
This is after the character in Friends, of course, isn't it?
Yes, yes. I'm one of these people that even if the house is clean, I'll find something else to clean. I know, it's terrible. I have to be honest, though, since having a baby, I don't really care as much.
No, we haven't got
you
time.
You just haven't got time to worry. It's like the last thing that you think about, cleaning the house, when you're looking after an 11-month-year-old or chasing an 11-month-year-old around the house.
And when they get older, they can clean for you.
Exactly. That's why you have kids, right?
One of the reasons. Hey, listen, good luck with the music.
Thank
good luck
so
with the
much.
Campaign. Always great to see you.
Lovely
you'll
to
hang
you
around,
too.
Won't you?
Yes, definitely.
Excellent. After break, I'll have a rundown of this week's best viral videos with comedian Matt Ford, plus actor Simon Callow will be here. See you in a few minutes.
Be ready for the weekend. Simply Be proudly sponsors ITV Weekend Breakfast.
I feel a shaking of the ground I stand on.
The world is changing.
If you have something to say, say it.
I can't just stand here following orders for the rest of my life.
Our grandchild is about to be stolen from us forever.
I have a secret. A bad secret.
This house has no secrets.
What would you say to my scandalous suggestion?
You're a very naughty boy.
Surely servants are human beings too.
Yes, preferably only on their days off.
I think everything about Downton is beautiful.
Downton is catching up with the times we live in.
That is exactly what I am afraid of.
Welcome back to Downton Abbey. The new series starts Sunday, 21st of September at 9 on ITV.
Euro qualifier, Switzerland versus England, tomorrow at 7:15, live and free on ITV.
Do you believe in life after death, Mr. Witcher?
Now, none of this is any of your business.
A man is dead.
I think it is my business.
I want that person found.
Paddy Considine returns in The Suspicions of Mr. Witcher tonight at 9:05 on ITV.
This is our chance to start again, to become the big men of Rome.
Hey!
Cynthia, it's Marcus. Shall I tell him you're out?
Wow. I can't hear all this, by the way.
Hey, Marcus.
Why do people go to the gym when you can just get one of these?
Oh, I like that.
I wish we had more money.
Well, that didn't work, did it?
Multi-award-winning comedy Plebs, coming soon on ITV2.
Anyone who ever dreamed could look at me and know I dream of you, knowing I love you so.
I've had enough, Bobby. I want to go home.
Anyone who had a heart would...
If I lose you, then I'll have nothing.
New three-part drama, Scylla, starts September the 15th on ITV.
Hello, I'm Warwick Davis, and welcome to Celebrity Squares.
Shut the front door.
Yeah! It's a simple game of noughts and crosses.
I disagree.
What?
So join me for a brand new series of Celebrity Squares.
Be there and be square.
Ooh, that could be my catchphrase. Wednesday at 8 on ITV.
Be ready for the weekend. Simply Be proudly sponsors ITV Weekend Breakfast.
Welcome back to Weekend with my musical guests, Alicia Dixon and Anastasia, who's getting ready to perform again at the end of the show. But now it's time for one of my favourite parts, where we find out which viral videos are setting the internet alight this week. And to bring us up to speed with his trending trio of clips is comedian Matt Ford. Welcome back. How are you?
I'm all right. I feel fitter than the last time I saw you.
You look very shiny, as if you've had a good wash.
All right, mate. Flipping it. Well, like sweaty. Do you think I look sweaty?
No, you look fine.
I came here thinking, you know what, I've sorted myself out. I went for a run before coming in here.
That's what I meant.
It's not a compliment, is it?
No, you look fresh.
Nice to meet you, love. By the way, you look lovely and shiny.
I meant fresh. You really do look fresh.
But shiny, is that...
No, you're not shiny. You're going a bit red now because I think you're embarrassed.
Because he's flirting with me.
Shiny, you want to be shiny. Oh, almighty.
Oh, Aled, crikey. First thing in the morning, man.
Sorry.
Right, the first video I've got.
Yes.
So I always find that the videos that are getting like the most hits online or whatever.
Okay.
But the funniest ones as well.
Okay.
This... I've never seen a grandma behave like this before.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Right, okay.
I stood back with my friends when mentioned something. Grabbed a hold of me tightly. Flow like a harpoon daily and nightly. Will it ever stop? Yo, I don't know. Turn off the lights and I'll glow. To the extreme, I rock a mic like a vandal.
What a grandma.
Love that.
She knows how to have fun in dinner time, doesn't she?
I'm like that in my kitchen.
Are you?
Yeah.
That makes sense because you're like a pop star. But that's... it raises a lot of questions about what Nan was up to before she had kids.
Do you think? I thought it was Maureen Lipman at one point when it zoomed in on her.
She's been eating a lot of the stock, hasn't she, if that's Lipman.
Very good.
It just... I feel sorry for the grandson. Me and Nan can dance, but that pasta's clearly done. Come on, yeah, woman.
Absolutely.
4 minutes later and it's still... that would have been ruined now.
I like the look of the dog's face just looking up there going, oh, God, oh,
that's
my...
what keeps this young
all the time.
Dancing.
Oh, do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah, she had good rhythm as well.
She was good.
Yeah.
It must keep the flavour in that relationship as well.
Yeah.
Or granddad filming it. There's one bit where he puts the 20 quid in the top of her trousers, but they cut that bit out.
That's just not true, is it?
No, it's not. No. This second clip is arguably the coolest pet in the world.
Oh, okay, well, let's have a look. It looks like he's playing the harp.
Oh,
well, I've got to say, it's only at the end of the clip when he starts eating the water, I thought, oh, it's not a real... he's not actually playing it.
Oh, it's disappointing.
I thought they'd found, like, a musical water harp. And
wouldn't it be brilliant, a water harp?
Who would have done good on BGT?
Yeah. And how?
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, but it wasn't a real water harp.
It was just a sprinkler that's sprinkler,
yeah.
Come afterwards.
Don't want to spoil it for you.
Well, it's only at the end now, so hang on a minute.
Very...
you felt cheated.
Broke my heart, but
your harp?
My harp, sorry. right, well, the third one, I need to chill out. This third and final clip,
yeah,
is, okay. Well, arguably, witchcraft.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Okay.
So many people have heard about Beckett and have heard about this play. The
actually been published for the time of there is a published version, and then they have an introduction. Whereas today, we're usually production versions of the published version. Many of them have read Thomas Mann's letter and they're really excited about it. So, despite the fact that it's in a small theater, tucked away, many people want to see it, and they head over.
That's incredible, isn't it? That's really proper. That's awesome.
That's really
good. Eat that dynamo.
The fact that the guy's really studiously trying to learn as well and gets really annoyed that they're making the noise.
That's really good.
All his first instinct is to check himself out. If you watch it back, they wiggle his nose or whatever they do. Then his first thing when he looks up, he just sort of checks himself in the camera to make sure he's still cool. Quite nice.
Hey, listen, thanks for being here. It's
always
been great.
Pleasure,
really great to see you all series as well.
And
they were brilliant. No, you don't look so that fresh anymore now.
But shiny in a cool way.
You're more shiny than you were when you arrived.
Yeah.
And less fresh. Thanks, mate.
Cheers.
Time for some Talking in the Air, where we meet fascinating people from around the world. And as you know, we love meeting the animals as well on the show. Last week, it was a sea lion, Gina, from Blackpool Zoo, with her trainer, Alex. Well, this week, we've decided to downsize a bit. Let's say hello to Tyson, with his owner, Rose McClendon, in Lincolnshire. Good morning, Rose. How are you?
Good morning, Alex. I'm fine, thank you.
So that is Tyson. Tyson is tiny.
He is, yes.
What breed is Tyson?
He's a cross between a Lhasa Apso and a Chihuahua.
Okay, and is it true that he's Britain's tiniest dog?
Well, he's definitely in the run for it, yeah.
And how long have you had Tyson?
Well, we've had him since birth, so he's nearly 4 months old.
Okay, will he grow to be much bigger?
I don't think so. He hasn't grown at all for weeks. He's still 4 inches high from floor to shoulder.
It's very difficult to see actually how small he is. Can you show us properly?
Well, that's the side view of Tyson.
Right.
And if I've got a standard pin here, and if I hold that up against him.
Right. This just seems like a random thing to do on a Sunday morning. Here's a tin, and here's my dog.
I don't know whether you can see that.
Absolutely. Have you ever lost him?
Yes, we're always losing him.
Oh, are you? Okay, and is it possible to take kind of Tyson out for normal walks? I don't imagine you need a very big poo bag.
Not yet. The link's heavy for him.
All right, so he just runs around the house?
Yes, he does. And the garden, he runs around the garden as well.
Well, we think Tyson's absolutely adorable. Thanks so much for sharing him with us this morning, Rose. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Steve. Thank you.
See, I bet your daughter would love a little Tyson.
Oh, he's so sweet.
Have you got a pet?
Six dogs.
No.
Yeah.
What a god.
Big ones, small ones?
Pointer, who's quite
big. How big would the can have to be for me to have an
Very, very big.
Oh, really?
And lots of Cocker Spaniels.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Why six?
Because I rescue dogs. I can't help it.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a problem of mine.
Rose, if the door goes and there's Alicia, don't answer it, okay? After the break, we've got more music from Anastasia, and Simon Callow will also be here. See you in a few minutes.
Ready for the weekend? Simply Be proudly sponsors ITV Weekend Breakfast.
Everywhere by Fleetwood Mac has sold an awful lot of hot tubs.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to the Hot Tub Superstore.
We are officially bonkers busy.
Slip your shoes off and jump in the spa.
The Hot Tub Mania is sweeping the nation.
What's something that looks good in my garden? Nothing tacky.
And this family-run business is cashing in on the craze.
I like to sit back, watch the stars.
It's the best thing I've ever bought.
You can almost become euphoric sat in the tub.
Hot Tub Britain, Tuesday at 9 on ITV.
Tech Santa and CITV are launching a brand new competition, Christmas Share a Story. If you are aged between 5 and 12, we want to hear your Christmas tales. They must feature Santa Claus and the fun of sharing at Christmas. One lucky winner will have their story animated and shown on ITV and CITV. We must have your story by Friday the 26th of September. Head over to techsanta.co.uk to find out how to enter. So start sharing!
Taylor's with you now. I'm begging you.
Claire, come home to me.
We've been best friends forever.
Where were you at noon today?
Driving.
At work.
Stop lying!
And I miss you so much.
Hello?
People really love you, Tay. More people than you know and more than you know. So don't hurt her. Please, just don't hurt her.
Stop!
Chasing Shadows continues Thursday at 9 on ITV.
This is going to be one heck of a competition.
I think that I can comment more on lyrics than you.
Holy hotness!
The quest for the best continues. The X Factor, tonight from 8 on ITV.
Once upon a time, there was an 11-year-old girl who didn't own a single book. Then, with just one story and the help of her parents, she learned to read and a whole new world opened up before her eyes. And this is not a fairy tale.
Just read next week on Good Morning Britain.
Be ready for the weekend. Simply Be proudly sponsors ITV Weekend Breakfast.
Welcome back to Weekend with my guests Alicia Dixon and Anastasia, who's getting ready to perform again very shortly. Really looking forward to that. But my final guest today is an award-winning actor, director and writer who's worked in television and theatre for over 30 years now. He's also written 16 books. He's had great success with his one-man shows, playing Shakespeare, Charles Dickens and Oscar Wilde, not at the same time. This time round, he's looking at the life of Jesus. Here to tell us more, please welcome Simon Callow. Nice to see you.
You too.
So, back touring.
Hi.
Yes, back touring.
Are you ever at home?
Rarely, it has to be said. I do love it, though, and I do kind of feel it's what actors were born to do, to take the goods out around the place, you know?
Yeah.
And also, it's lovely to see the, you know, our country, which is so fascinating and amazing. And this time around, I'm going to places I've never been to, ever.
Those places exist, do they?
They exist, yes. hiding away from me. Places in all over, I mean, in Ireland, in Scotland, in Wales, in the West Country, in the North, in the Midlands. Okay. Fantastic, interesting places.
And it's the one-man show concept again. As I mentioned, yeah. You've done Shakespeare, you've done Dickens, yeah. You've done Oscar Wilde. I suppose Jesus was the obvious next one.
Yes, I know.
But he's not in it.
He's not in it. No, well, he's not. There are 12 characters in it. Not the 12 apostles, but there's Mary and Pontius Pilate and Herod Antipas and Judas and so on. The people who, all of whom speak of Jesus and are dealing with Jesus, and we only ever hear anything that Jesus says in their voices.
Okay.
And they all have different accents and places. So you never actually, as it were, hear the voice of Jesus, but you get reflections of him.
That's really cool.
From all these different angles.
How long did it take you to get something like this into your body, to learn it?
Gosh, it's quite a tough one. We did it a year ago in Belfast, but now it's been almost completely rewritten. And you just have to sit down and do it, that's all. It doesn't take a massively long time. It'll take a week, I suppose, to get the whole script into my brain.
Okay.
But it is quite a lot. But I've just done a play, another one-man play, and at the end of it, a woman very kindly said to me, "It's just amazing," she said. "You spoke for 75 minutes and you hardly drew breath." And her husband said, "But you do that all the time."
Does it get very lonely for you touring on your own all the time?
No, not at all. Because, of course, I have my team. I've got the company manager and the stage manager and all that. And then I have the audience, you know. And one-man shows, of course, have a very direct connection
of course,
with audiences.
Yeah.
It's very particular. And in this case, it's different because I'm playing just these 12 characters. Very often I do shows in which I actually talk to the audience directly. That's a very direct and lovely communication. And, you know, in the end, that's why we do theatre, isn't it? Because of the relationship with the audience.
But it's interesting, though, because, you know, coming from a music background, as both of you do, we like having the people behind as well, the band, the support mechanism on stage with us, you know.
Yeah. But, people often say, you know, aren't you worried about forgetting lines or there's nobody to help you out? But in the end, perhaps it's easier in a one-man show because you could just make it up.
Yeah.
They never know.
It won't worry anybody else, you know.
You got into this through your grandmother.
Acting?
Yeah. She took you to see Peter Pan, didn't she?
Yeah, that's right. That's absolutely right. When I was a very little boy, indeed, four or five or something.
But it had
like
a massive impact on you.
Well, huge, and it's fantastic because it was a very cold Christmas, of course, and I was freezing and I was crying and very noisy child I was, and wept and wept and wept and complained and blah, blah, blah. And then suddenly, the moment that I got into the theatre and the lights started to go down and the curtain went up, I was just absolutely spellbound. So they thought, get this child into the theatre whenever possible. It'll shut him up.
But she sounds great because she had perfect pitch. Yeah. Your grandmother, but she wouldn't let you sing anywhere near her.
It wasn't me, but her children that she wouldn't let sing near her. And so the result that, you know, it's like songs my mother never taught me. My mother really, really was completely tone deaf.
Right.
My mother was quite a strict person. She was a very high-powered secretary, and everything was totally organised in the house. Yeah.
Amazing. And the fact that you ended up working in the National Theatre, you've got to tell this story because it all stems from a letter you wrote.
That's right. I was a bit of a letter writer in those days. I'd written a letter to the Queen because my great grandfather, my grandmother's father, was a stained glass artist, and he made a stained glass of St George, and he wrote a little monograph, and he sent it to Buckingham Palace. And this is before the First World War. And so normally the royal family turns things down. But they accepted this monograph.
Okay.
But we didn't have a copy of it. My grandmother said to me one day, I always wondered what it would be like and I'd love to see it. So I said, I'll write to the Queen. So I wrote to the Queen and the great day arrived when I came back home and there was the postman, sort of trembling, with a letter in his hand which had no stamp on it. It just had the words, On Her Majesty's Personal Service.
Wow.
And so I was a god. It wasn't actually from her, but from her librarian, but yeah. It was very charming. So anyway, I had therefore the courage to write. When I first went to the Old Vic, when Laurence Olivier was running it, the National Theatre was at the Old Vic, and I just adored the shows. And one day I got the strong, strong feeling. It wasn't that I felt that I wanted to be an actor. I had no expectation of that. There was no school drama in my school. But I just thought, this is such a wonderful organisation. Because everybody, as far as I could see, in the box office, the ushers, the people selling ice cream, everybody seemed to feel part of the organisation. And there were these great, great shows going on with Maggie Smith and Joan Plowright and so on, and Sir Laurence himself. And so I sat down and I wrote him a 3 foolscap page, closely typed letter, explaining to him what an excellent theatre he was running, and he wrote back a letter by return of post and said, well, if you like it so much, why don't you come and work here? We have a job in the box office. And so I went to work in the box office, and that was really the beginning of my involvement with the theatre.
You've had such a phenomenal career, TV, stage, film. You know, I bet a day doesn't go by when someone doesn't talk about 4 weddings and a funeral, for instance,
right,
and Gareth,
that.
You know. What was it like being part of something like that?
Well, you know, like so many of the things we do, it was a very, very pressured shoot because it was shot in 6 6-day weeks.
All right.
And they had no money at all, so we couldn't, like, we went all over the country, but we couldn't stay anywhere in that because they couldn't afford to put us up. So a sort of little bus would drive us back and forth every day. And so, and we were working very long, long, long days on the set. But the thing is, we knew that it was the most wonderful screenplay. Yeah. It was just fantastic. From the beginning, everybody knew that.
Your character as well. Just
well, exactly. Right. And I do so well remember getting the script. And I was going on a plane to Manchester and I read it on the plane. And it said 4 weddings and a funeral. And I said to the person I was with, the producer, I said, I bet I'm the funeral. And that I was, and I was glad because it was such an excellent death.
It certainly was. Out of everything you do, I mentioned, you know, the prolific book writer, TV, film, and also the directing, of course, because you directed Shirley Valentine in the West End with
I did.
Paul Lynn Collins.
And Carmen Jones. And all
yeah. If you could only do one of them for the rest of your life, which would it be?
God. Well, I
writing. God's the next play.
Exactly. Writing. I suppose it would be.
Oh, really?
I love writing.
Oh, I didn't expect you to say that.
That was always my ambition as a child, to be a writer. And I wrote and wrote and wrote as a child, the way you do, until even I got bored with it, because it was all about me. And I could see the limitations of that subject. And then finally, when I became an actor, I then had a subject, and I started to write about the theatre. But I still haven't done what I always wanted to do, which was to write novels and plays. And I do long to do that still.
And away from acting, what else are your interests? Because watching television is not one of them. You didn't have a television for decades.
That's
I hear.
True. It's absolutely true. Only because of time, you know.
Right.
If you're going to do as many things as I wanted to do, where would you find the time to do television and watch television? And a television, as everybody knows, is one of those things that sucks you in. Mm. You know, that's the one thing you can't do if you're trying to portion up your time like this. But yes, I mean, I cook. I enjoy cooking very, very much indeed. I'm not particularly good at it, but I love cooking. And I go to our calories. But the truth is, I don't have very much time at all.
No.
But it's too pressured, frankly. I mean, I just don't really ever get a day where I just do nothing, which I think is the great, most important thing in life, is to do nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, life's too busy, isn't it? But
yeah. I mean, when I was at university, the vice chancellor gave a great speech, and he said, the most important thing you ever do in this university will be to sit looking out of the window without a thought in your head.
Mm.
And it is true. Those are great creative moments.
I'm going to do that all afternoon when I come. I can't wait. The kids are at an age now that they look after themselves. Hey, listen, we've managed to do this whole interview without using the verb pop as a substitute for the words, because that's your biggest pet hate in the world.
I'm afraid it is, and I'm a torment to people. But
if I said let's pop to the shops?
Oh God, I mean, the people use the word pop for anything at all. They'll say, I once went to an A&E clinic. I fell over on stage oddly, and she said just pop yourself down on that seat, pop your shoes off, pop your jacket off. The doctor's going to pop along in a minute. I'm just going to pop this needle in your arm, and then you can pop your head back onto the cushion, and then the doctor will pop his signature on the form, and then you can pop off. So it's a plague. It's a sort of a virus that has to be eliminated.
Okay. Well, I'm glad I didn't mention it. good luck with the tour. Always great to catch up with you.
Thank you.
And keep working.
All right.
time for more music. Performing her classic hit, Left Outside Alone. It's Anastasia.
To be left outside alone. I wonder if you know.
absolutely brilliant. And that's it for today. Thanks to Alicia Dixon. All the best with your charity project and the new music as well. Can't wait to hear that. Simon Callow, who's played The Man Jesus Begins its tour on the 10th of September, goes everywhere. And Anastasia, whose single Staring at the Sun is out now. And that's it from us for a while, but we will be back at Christmas. I'm already knitting my Christmas jumper. Have a great Sunday. Bye-bye.
Sponsors ITV Weekend Breakfast.
We counted all our reasons, excuses that we made. We found ourselves some.